థర్మల్ స్ట్రక్చర్ ఆఫ్ అట్మాస్ఫియర్. The objectives of learning this module are to understand the basics of atmospheric stratification into different layers and significance of the roles played by these layers, the dynamics, physical and chemical, of the atmospheric layers, and importance of atmospheric layers for survival of life. Introduction. Atmosphere, atmos, vapor, Latin, sphere, refers to a thin layer of gases surrounding the earth, held in place by gravity of the earth. This gaseous envelope is the source of oxygen which sustains organisms and carbon dioxide used by plants, algae, and cyanobacteria. It also protects living organisms by preventing the entry of ultraviolet radiations from the sun. History and trend of research on the exploration of atmospheric structure. In recent years, with global discussions about air pollution, ozone formation, and climate change, and developments in technologies such as measuring instruments, airplanes, satellites, and computer programs, there has been extensive research on atmospheric dynamics, characterization of spatio-temporal stratification, and their sustainability, and so forth. Exploring the atmosphere. The fundamental exploration of the nature of atmosphere is contemporary to origin of human civilization itself, but a detailed recording of environmental parameters started in the line of present research since 16th to 18th century, with inventions of basic equipments, thermometer and barometer by Galileo in 1593 and by Evangelista Torricelli in 1643 respectively, the theories and principles, decrease of pressure with altitude by Florent Perrier in 1648, Gabriel Fahrenheit's introduction of temperature scale in 1714, James S. Pye's empirical estimation, and William Thomson's derivation of dry and saturated lapse rate in 1850s and 1862 respectively, development of laws of thermodynamics in 1940s, and kinetic theories of gases by James Maxwell in 1866. Based on these bases, the exploratory study of atmospheric layers began with Alexander Wilson's use of a thermometer on a kite in 1749, followed by manned balloon exploration by Joseph Louis Gay Lussac in 1804, and subsequent use of instrumented balloons by Léon Philippe Tisserens de Bort in 1898. This exploratory spree manifested in terms of better understanding of atmospheric structure, especially with G.J. Story's proposition of exosphere in 1868, Balfour Stewart's study on existence of electrical currents in upper atmosphere in 1882, Tisserens de Bort's discovery of isothermal layer about 12 kilometers upwards in 1901, and nomenclature of the words troposphere and stratosphere in 1908, as well as D. Guglielmo Marconi's reception of transatlantic radio signal reflected back from upper atmosphere in 1901, and the prediction of existence of ionosphere by Oliver Heaviside and Arthur Kennelly independently in 1902. Zone of silence. Discovery of zone of silence to imply temperature inversion existing above troposphere during 1915 is probably the first well-documented experimental studies on atmospheric stratification. The railway gun, capable of firing a 106-kilogram shell to a range of 130 kilometers and a maximum altitude of 42.3 kilometers, used during the First World War to shell Paris 120 kilometers away, created a very loud noise. Our noise gets fainter as listeners are farther away. But with very loud noises, it was sometimes noted that there was a zone of silence where no noise could be heard. But surprisingly, the sound became audible again further away. Several explanations were offered to explain this apparent anomalous sound. After the First World War, scientists used loud guns to study the effect, and from the results were able to show that the atmospheric temperature in the stratosphere increases up to an altitude of about 50 kilometers. Thermal stratification. By 1920, the thermal stratification of lower atmospheric layers were fairly well understood. With additional inference from observed altitude of meteors by Gordon Dobson during 1920. In 1924, Edward Appleton developed ionosonde to explore upper atmosphere, using which he confirmed existence of ionosphere, nomenclature by Robert Watson Watt in 1925. The era of usage of rockets and satellites in atmospheric investigations started Robert Goddard's first rocket probe of atmosphere in 1929, continued with regard to upper atmosphere during 1948, and subsequent launching of the Sputnik 1 in 1957 to study general stratification, Explorer 1, 1958, to discover Van Allen radiation belt, and Explorer 12, 1963, to detect magnetopause. During this period, there was better understanding of magnetosphere, which was proposed by Sidney Chapman and Vincent Ferraro in 1930, the name coined by Thomas Gold in 1959. The discovery of the mesopause and plasma pause were carried out by W.G. Stroud's team, 1959, and Donald Carpenter, 1963, respectively. Since then, the studies have been more directed towards routine investigation and monitoring, as well as computational modeling and simulation of the atmospheric layers. The political, economic, and social changes that came after the Second World War have also had an impact on the atmospheric sciences and how they are carried out. During the Cold War, important innovations like LIDAR, light detection and ranging, and new satellite technologies emerged, and global models and computer simulations were applied. In addition, the atmospheric sciences have become politically relevant in the domains of air transport, air pollution, and climate change. Evolution of atmosphere. Stage 1. Earliest atmosphere is expected to have consisted of gases in the solar nebula, primarily hydrogen and possibly simple hydrides, as observed in gas giants like Jupiter and Saturn, water vapor, methane and ammonia. With dissipation of solar nebula, these gases would have escaped, partly driven off by the solar wind. Stage 2. Second atmosphere is likely to be consisting largely of nitrogen plus carbon dioxide and inert gases, which was produced by outgassing from volcanism, supplemented by gases produced during the late heavy bombardment of Earth by huge asteroids. A major part of carbon dioxide emissions would have dissolved in water and built up carbonate sediments. An influence of life, which would have originated as early as 3.5 billion years, has to be taken into account in evolution of the atmosphere, because hints of early life forms are to be found. In fact, in the late Archean eon, an oxygen-containing atmosphere began to develop, apparently from photosynthesizing cyanobacteria, which have been found as stromatolite fossils from 2.7 billion years ago. Stage 3. Third atmosphere is the atmosphere we experience now with increasing oxygen content. In fact, the constant rearrangement of continents by plate tectonics would have influenced the second atmosphere through the long-term evolution of the atmosphere by transferring carbon dioxide to and from large continental carbonate stores. As per available existence, the free oxygen did not exist in the atmosphere until about 2.4 billion years ago during the Great Oxygenation Event. Its appearance is indicated by the end of the banded iron formations. Before this event, any oxygen produced by photosynthesis was consumed by oxidation of reduced materials, notably iron. Molecules of free oxygen did not start to accumulate in the atmosphere until the rate of production of oxygen began to exceed the availability of reducing materials. This point signifies a shift from a reducing atmosphere to an oxidizing atmosphere. Oxygen showed major variations until reaching a steady state of more than 15% by the end of the Precambrian. Composition of the atmosphere. About 75% of the total gas and 99% of the total water vapor of the entire atmosphere constitutes the troposphere, thus representing the 80% of total mass of the atmosphere. The following table lists the composition of constituents of atmosphere and their volume percentage of permanent and variable gases. Nitrogen, oxygen, and argon account for more than 99.96% of the atmosphere by volume. The permanent gases have virtually constant volume ratios up to an altitude of about 60 kilometers. Although the amounts of the variable gases are small, they are extremely important in determining the atmospheric temperature. Thermal structure of atmosphere. Based on the change composition with height, the atmosphere can be divided into two layers. The lower layer is called the homosphere because of homogeneity in composition, especially the tropospheric gases, which ranges from troposphere to mesopause, discussed in details later, overlain by the heterosphere, mostly thermosphere, in which the gases are stratified into four shells. The lowermost shell is dominated by molecular nitrogen, N2. Next, a layer of atomic oxygen, O, is encountered, followed by a layer dominated by helium atoms, HE, and finally, the topmost layer consisting of hydrogen atoms, H. However, the most exhaustive and characteristic stratification of atmosphere has been based on the vertical thermal profile of the layers. The temperature variation in these layers may be accounted to the absorption of solar radiation. Visible light at the surface, near ultraviolet radiation in the middle atmosphere, and far ultraviolet radiation in the upper atmosphere. The characteristics of various layers of atmosphere will be presented now. Troposphere. Troposphere means region of mixing and is so named because of vigorous convective air currents within the layer. It is closest to Earth, situated between 0 to 12 kilometers. This layer contains 75% of the gases and the largest percentage, around 80% of the mass of the total atmosphere, and is where all weather phenomena occurs, although turbulence may sometimes extend into the lower portion of the stratosphere. Here, with altitude, the temperature and water vapor content decreases. The troposphere contains 99% of the water vapor in the atmosphere, and this water vapor, highest at tropics and lowest at polar regions, plays a major role in regulating air temperature, because it absorbs solar energy and thermal radiation from the planet's surface. Tropopause, where temperature remains fairly constant, minus 60 degrees centigrade with altitude, and is located at the upper boundary of this layer, separating the troposphere from the stratosphere, whose height varies spatially from height of 8 kilometers near the poles up to 18 kilometers above the equator, and temporally highest in the summer and lowest in the winter. In tropopause, we find the jet stream, which are very strong winds that blow eastward and affect planetary circulation pattern. Stratosphere. Stratosphere or stratified sphere is the layer just above tropopause, situated between about 25 to 50 kilometers, where temperature increases gradually to up to the stratopause. In this layer, unlike troposphere, there is no convection and it is fairly stable. In stratosphere, there is the ozone layer, centered at an altitude between 15 to 25 kilometers, consisting of 90% of the ozone of the entire atmosphere, with concentration of about 10 parts per million by volume, ppmv, as compared to approximately 0.04 parts per million by volume in the troposphere. Ozone acts as a shield for the Earth's surface in absorbing the bulk of solar ultraviolet radiation in wavelengths from 290 nanometers to 320 nanometers, UVB radiation, which are harmful to life because they can be absorbed by the nucleic acid in cells, leading to increase in cancers in animals and damage in plant cells. Ozone is responsible in regulating the thermal regime of the stratosphere, converting solar energy to kinetic energy. This causes a temperature increase in the upper part of the layer because temperature increases with ozone concentration. Stratopause, the transitional zone of maximum temperature between the stratosphere and the mesosphere, is located within 50 to 55 kilometers above ground level. Mesosphere. Mesosphere or middle sphere is characterized by the portion of the atmosphere from about 50 to 80 kilometers above the Earth's surface, characterized by temperatures that decrease from 10 degrees centigrade to minus 90 degrees centigrade with increasing altitude, extending from stratopause to mesopause. The coldest temperatures in Earth's atmosphere occur at the top of this layer, especially in the summer near the pole. This layer protects the Earth from meteoroids, which get burnt up in this region. The mesosphere has sometimes jocularly been referred to as the ignorosphere because it had been probably the least studied of the atmospheric layers. The stratosphere and mesosphere together are sometimes referred to as the middle atmosphere. The mesopause is the temperature minimum, the coldest place on Earth with temperatures as low as minus 100 degrees centigrade at the boundary between the mesosphere and the thermosphere due to the lack of solar heating and very strong radiative cooling from carbon dioxide. The mesopause is the temperature minimum zone at the boundary between the mesosphere and the thermosphere atmospheric regions at 80 to 85 kilometers due to the lack of solar heating and very strong radiative cooling from carbon dioxide. Thermosphere. Thermosphere or heat sphere is the layer of the Earth's atmosphere extending from the top of the mesopause, 80 kilometers to 90 kilometers above the surface, to thermopause, about 500 kilometers, and is characterized by a rapid increase in temperature due to the absorption of intense solar radiation by the limited amount of remaining molecular oxygen, with increasing altitude up to about 200 kilometers, followed by a leveling off in the 300 kilometer to 500 kilometer region, reaching up to 1700 degrees centigrade to even more than 2000 degrees centigrade. At this extreme altitude, Gas molecules are widely separated, and above an altitude of 100 kilometers, the chemical composition of air becomes strongly dependent on altitude, and the atmosphere becomes enriched with lighter gases, atomic oxygen, helium, and hydrogen. Above about 160 kilometers altitude, the major atmospheric component becomes atomic oxygen. At the very high altitudes, the residual gases begin to stratify according to molecular mass because of gravitational separation. The thermopause is the atmospheric boundary located at the top of the thermosphere. In fact, the low gravitational attraction in this zone is unable to support aircraft, and therefore vehicles need to travel at orbital velocities to stay aloft. This demarcation between aeronautics and astronautics is known as the Kármán line. This line is named after Theodor von Kármán, 1881-1963, a Hungarian-American engineer and physicist who was the first to calculate that around this altitude, and this commonly represents the boundary between the Earth's atmosphere and outer space, standardized by the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale, FAI, which is an international standard-setting and record-keeping body for aeronautics, the science or art involved with the study, design, and manufacturing of air flight-capable machines, and the techniques of operating aircraft and rocketry within the atmosphere, and astronautics, or science and technology of space flight, is the theory and practice of navigation beyond the Earth's atmosphere. The electromagnetic characterization of thermosphere constitutes three overlapping layers, that is, ionosphere, magnetosphere, and plasmasphere, which we shall now discuss. Ionosphere is the zone extending from stratosphere to the lower part of the thermosphere, where gas particles absorb ultraviolet and X-ray radiation from the sun and become electrically charged ions. Radio waves are bounced off the ions and reflect waves back to Earth. This generally helps radio communication. However, solar flares can increase the number of ions and can interfere with the transmission of some radio waves. The transitional zone in the atmosphere between the ionosphere and the exosphere, about 644 kilometers from the Earth's surface, is known to be ionopause. Magnetosphere. The outer layer of ionosphere, some sources consider them to be separate, where the Earth's magnetic field operates, is called magnetosphere. It begins at about 1,000 kilometers. It is made up of positively charged protons and negatively charged electrons, which traps the particles that are given off by the sun and are concentrated into belts of deadly radiation called the Van Allen radiation belts. When large amounts of such particles are given off during a solar flare, the collision of these particles among one another causes the aurora borealis or the northern lights, a natural light display in the sky, particularly in the high latitude regions. In this layer, the magnetic field lines are unable to co-rotate because they are influenced strongly by electric fields of solar wind origin. Thus, the magnetosphere is a cavity, also not spherical, in which the Earth's magnetic field is constrained by the solar wind and interplanetary magnetic field, IMF. This gives rise to an elongated teardrop shape with a tail pointing away from the sun. The outer boundary of the magnetosphere is called the magnetopause, which is typically located at some 56,000 kilometers, about 10 Earth radii, above the Earth's surface on the day side, and stretches into a long tail, the magnetotail, a few million kilometers long, about 1,000 Earth radii, well past the orbit of the Moon at around 60 Earth radii on the night side of the Earth. Plasmasphere. Plasmasphere, also considered as inner magnetosphere, is essentially an extension of the ionosphere. It is a region of the Earth's magnetosphere consisting of low energy, cool plasma, composed mostly of hydrogen ions, protons and electrons, and is located above the ionosphere. This is not really spherical, but a donut-shaped region, a torus, with the whole aligned with Earth's magnetic axis. In this case, the use of the suffix sphere is more in the figurative sense of a sphere of influence. The outer edge of this donut over the equator is usually 19,000 to 32,000 kilometers above the surface, some 4 to 6 times Earth radii. The plasma sphere has a very sharp edge, known as the plasma pores, inside which the geomagnetic field lines rotate with the Earth. The inner edge of the plasma sphere is taken as the altitude at which protons replace oxygen as the dominant species in the ionospheric plasma, which usually occurs at about 1,000 kilometers altitude. Exosphere. The uppermost part of the thermosphere that extends from about 550 kilometers to thousands of kilometers is known to be exosphere. Air is very thin here, unable to retain upward-traveling molecules' attempts to escape to space, especially if they are moving fast enough or be pulled back to Earth by gravity if they are slow enough, with little probability of colliding with another molecule. This is the area where satellites orbit the Earth and the altitude of its lower boundary, known as the thermopause or exobase, ranging from about 250 to 500 kilometers depending on solar activity. The upper boundary can be defined theoretically by the altitude, about 2 lakh kilometers, half the distance to the Moon, that is 384,403 kilometers, at which the influence of solar radiation pressure on atomic hydrogen velocities exceeds that of the Earth's gravitational pull. The exosphere is observable from space as the geocorona, where the solar far ultraviolet light that is reflected off the cloud of neutral hydrogen atoms that surrounds the Earth and is seen to extend to at least 96,000 kilometers from the surface of the Earth. The exosphere is a transitional zone between Earth's atmosphere and interplanetary space. Factors affecting atmospheric temperature at troposphere. As mentioned before, the troposphere is characterized by a decrease in temperature with respect to height, from a mean surface temperature of about 15 degrees centigrade to a temperature of about minus 53 degrees centigrade. The temperature structure of this layer is a consequence of radiative balance and the convective transport of energy from the surface to the atmosphere. Virtually all water vapor, clouds and precipitation are confined in this layer. Since this is the most studied component of atmosphere because of its direct relationship with most of the weather phenomena, atmospheric temperature is governed by many factors. We will now look into their explanations. Insolation. Insolation, short for incident or incoming solar radiation, is a measure of solar radiation energy received on a given surface area and recorded during a given time. It is also called solar irradiation and expressed as hourly irradiation if recorded during an hour, or daily irradiation if recorded during a day. Increased insolation directly increases temperature. Humidity. It is the amount of water vapor in the air, measured by mass of water vapor per unit volume of total air and water vapor, called absolute humidity, or as ratio partial pressure of water vapor in air water mixture to saturated water vapor of water, called relative humidity. More than 50% of water vapor is concentrated below about 850 millibar, while more than 90% is confined to the layer below about 500 millibar. The variability of the water concentration shows bimodal distribution, with a maximum in the subtropics of both hemispheres below about 700 millibar. The variability is very small in the equatorial region and poleward of about 60 degrees. The stratospheric water concentration is relatively small, with a value of about 3 to 4 parts per million volume in the lower stratosphere. It has been suggested that water in the lower stratosphere is controlled by the temperature of the tropical tropopause and by the formation and dissipation of cirrus anvils due to outflow from cumulonimbus clouds. Altitude. This is the distance measurement, usually in the vertical or up direction, between a reference datum and a point or object. In troposphere, temperature decreases with altitude, as discussed before, and the rate of decrease is called lapse rate. Although the actual atmospheric lapse rate varies, under normal atmospheric conditions, the average atmospheric lapse rate results in a temperature decrease of 6.5 degrees centigrade per kilometer of altitude. The measurable lapse rate is affected by humidity. A dry lapse rate of 10 degrees centigrade per kilometer is often used to calculate temperature changes in air not at 100% relative humidity. This is called dry adiabatic lapse rate, or DALR. A wet lapse rate of 5.5 degrees centigrade per kilometer is used to calculate the temperature changes in air that is saturated. This is called saturated lapse rate, or SLR. However, in a particular region, sometimes the temperature can increase with height in the lower troposphere based on the atmospheric condition. When this happens, it is called an inversion. However, if the temperature remains the same with height, it is called isothermal. Thus, the actual lapse rate at any region, called environmental lapse rate, varies with location, time of day, weather conditions, season, etc. Type of biome. Also known as ecosystem, this refers to contiguous areas with similar climatic conditions on the earth, such as communities of plants, animals, and soil organisms. Depending on the biome, there is variation of transpiration and gaseous exchange, which can affect the temperature, mostly at surface level. The height of the troposphere varies spatio-temporally too. It is more like 8 kilometers over the polar regions in a winter. Cold air tends to settle downward, and 18 kilometers over the equatorial regions due to greater convection there, heating caused by the direct rays of the sun. In the mid-latitudes, it is lower in winter and higher in summer for the same sorts of reasons. Instruments in study of atmospheric layers. The standard equipment used globally in study of atmospheric layer characteristics on regular basis is a weather or sounding system, which is a balloon, specifically a type of high-altitude balloon, which carries instruments aloft to send back information on atmospheric pressure, temperature, humidity, and wind speed by means of a small, expendable measuring device called a radio sonde. To obtain wind data, they can be tracked by radar, radio direction finding, or navigation systems such as the satellite-based Global Positioning System, GPS. Balloons meant to stay at a constant altitude for long periods of time are known as transosondes. Weather balloons. The balloon itself produces the lift and is usually made of a highly flexible latex material, though chloroprene may also be used. The unit that performs the actual measurements and radio transmissions hangs at the lower end of the string. Specialized radio sondes are used for measuring particular parameters, such as determining the ozone concentration. The balloon is usually filled with hydrogen due to lower cost, though helium can also be used. The ascent rate can be controlled by the amount of gas with which the balloon is filled. Weather balloons may reach altitudes of 40 kilometers or more, limited by diminishing pressures, causing the balloon to expand to such a degree, typically by a 100:1 factor, that it disintegrates. In this instance, the instrument package is usually lost. Above that altitude, sounding rockets are used, and for even higher altitudes, satellites are used. Global distributions of weather balloons. Major manufacturers of balloons are Zhuzhou Research and Design Institute, ChemChina Rubber Corp., brand Fuo Yi, China, Totex and Cosmoprene of Japan, and Pavan Rubber Products, Pavan Exports, brand Pavan of India. Weather balloons are launched around the world for observations, used to diagnose current conditions, as well as by human forecasters and computer models for weather forecasting. About 800 locations around the globe do routine releases twice daily, usually at 0000 UTC and 1200 UTC. UTC is Universal Time Code. Some facilities will also do occasional supplementary special releases when meteorologists determine there is a need for additional data between the 12-hour routine launches, in which time much can change in the atmosphere. Military and civilian government meteorological agencies, such as the National Weather Service in the US, typically launch balloons, and by international agreements, almost all the data are shared with all nations. Specialized uses also exist, such as for aviation interests, pollution monitoring, photography or videography, and research. Use of optical beams. Cloud height and visibility are two other important parameters which are required for meteorological measurements, especially in tropospheric and lower stratospheric studies. Both use optical beams of various types, often lidars. For example, ceilometers determine the base of the cloud height by sending up pulses of light towards this cloud. Upon encountering the cloud, the light pulses are partially reflected to the ground where they are detected. The time delay between transmission and reception of the light pulses is used to determine the base height of the clouds. Visibility instruments usually measure the reduction of intensity of narrow light beams as they traverse across a designated region. Sky cameras. In relation to clouds, it is also not uncommon to record the percentage of cloud cover, and often all sky cameras are used to do this. A simple all-sky camera, which can be made by photographing the image seen in a highly polished metal sphere with a radius of typically 15 to 30 centimeters. After those early flights, and especially in the 1960s and 1970s, scientists started developing their own rockets for middle atmosphere research. These rockets were smaller than the V-2s, but were especially designed for scientific payloads. These rockets carry a variety of different payloads, and the compositions of the payloads vary from rocket to rocket, depending on the planned experiments. Examples include pressure sensors, density sensors, mass spectrometers, dust detectors for detecting meteoric dust, ion gauges, Langmuir probes, electron density gauges, and many others. Winds and dynamical motions form a key subject for investigation at these high altitudes. Use of rockets. The winds are very large and highly variable, especially at heights of 80 to 100 kilometers. One early method for measurement of upper level winds was to release a trail of luminescent gas behind the rocket as it flies upward. These particular measurements are best made at sunset or sunrise. The trail is blown around by the wind and also develops a puffy appearance due to local turbulence. By taking photographs of these trails from the ground using high-resolution cameras and using multiple cameras so that triangulation can be used, it is possible to determine both the upper-level winds from the trail drifts and the strength of turbulence from the rate of expansion of the puffy trail. Many other rocket experiments are carried out, but there is currently no real regular worldwide program of middle atmosphere rocket measurements like the radio sonde program. Much of the information about the long-term availability of middle atmosphere winds is determined by radars and satellites. Use of satellites. As rockets became more powerful, it was eventually possible to use them to place satellites in orbit. The first successful satellite was lifted to orbit by Russian scientists and engineers on the 4th of October 1957 and was called Sputnik. Since then, many other satellites have been placed in orbit. Human and natural influences on the changing thermal structure of the atmosphere. The composition of the atmosphere plays an important role in the thermal structure, especially at troposphere. When we look at the typical composition of atmosphere, as shown in the table earlier, although carbon dioxide is listed as a permanent constituent, its concentration has been increasing by about 0.4% per year as a result of combustion of fossil fuels, absorption and release by the oceans, and photosynthesis. In addition, a number of measurement series indicate that the atmospheric methane concentration, with a present value of about 1.7 parts per million by volume, PPMV, has increased by 1 to 2% per year, and that it may have been increasing for a long period of time. The most likely cause of the increase in the methane concentration is the greater biogenic emissions associated with rising human population. Rice paddies seem to be another prime source of CH4 or methane. There is no direct evidence of an increase in carbon monoxide concentration. However, deforestation, biomass burning, and modification of CH4 methane sources could lead to changes in the atmospheric carbon monoxide concentration. There are also some evidences of an increase in nitrous oxide. A possible global increase of about 0.2% per year in nitrous oxide has been suggested. This increase is attributed to the combustion of fossil fuels, biomass, and in part to fertilizer denitrification. Ozone concentration. Ozone concentration also varies significantly with space, latitude, and time, season, maximum occurring during polar night. Although it occurs principally at the ozone layer, 15 to 30 kilometers, where it is continually created and destroyed by photochemical processes associated with solar UV radiation, and thus protects the life on Earth by absorbing these deadly solar radiations, it is also formed in troposphere by anthropogenic activities, in which case ozone is toxic to all living beings. In fact, many photochemical reactions associated with ozone involve water vapor, methane, and carbon monoxide, which are directly related to various anthropogenic activities affecting ozone balance of the lower atmosphere. Change in temperature regime of atmosphere. Since the late 1970s, satellite-based instruments have monitored global changes in atmospheric temperature. These measurements reveal multi-decadal tropospheric warming and stratospheric cooling, punctuated by short-term volcanic signals of reverse sign. Similar long and short-term temperature signals occur in model simulations driven by human-caused changes in atmospheric composition and natural variations in volcanic aerosols. Most of the studies involve two primary approaches. One, comparison of modeled and observed atmospheric temperature changes using results from individual models and individual observational records, or use of large multi-model archive and multiple observational data sets to identify with high statistical confidence in satellite data the human-caused latitude-altitude pattern of atmospheric temperature change. Structures of atmosphere in other planets. All planets of the solar system have atmospheres. This is because their gravity is strong enough to keep gaseous particles close to the surface. Larger gas giants are massive enough to keep large amounts of the light gases, hydrogen and helium, close by, while the smaller planets lose these gases into space. The composition of the Earth's atmosphere is different from the other planets because the various life processes that have transpired on the planet have introduced free molecular oxygen. Much of Mercury's atmosphere has been blasted away by the solar wind. The only moon that has retained a dense atmosphere is Titan. There is a thin atmosphere on Triton and a trace of an atmosphere on the moon. Dynamic weather systems in the planets. Planetary atmospheres are affected by varying degrees of energy received from either the sun or their interiors, leading to the formation of dynamic weather systems such as hurricanes on Earth, planet-wide dust storms on Mars, an Earth-sized anticyclone on Jupiter called the Great Red Spot, and holes in the atmosphere on Neptune. At least one extrasolar planet, HD 189733b, has been claimed to possess such a weather system similar to the Great Red Spot, but twice as large. Terrestrial planets. Both Mars and Venus have tropospheres of greater extent than the Earth, though for different reasons. The atmosphere of Mars is much thinner than that of the Earth, and there is less compression because of the weaker gravity of Mars. Although Venus has a weaker gravity than Earth, it has over 90 times the amount of atmosphere because of a runaway greenhouse effect that occurred at least hundreds of millions of years ago. That will be described further later, but it does provide a warning to us that drastic global climate change is possible. Because their tropospheres extend over a greater distance than the Earth's troposphere, the clouds of Mars and Venus are found at higher altitudes. Mars and Venus also possess thermospheres. What is missing is the temperature bump of a stratosphere and mesosphere because they do not have an ozone layer to absorb the ultraviolet light. Planet atmosphere models courtesy of Jerry Justice at the Marshall Space Flight Center, NASA. Jovian planets. The Jovian planets, that is, the planets that are essentially big balls of gas, each surrounded by many moons and rings, such as Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus and Neptune, in contrast to terrestrial planets, are all slightly oblong and rotate much faster than any of the terrestrial worlds. Gravity by itself would make a planet spherical, but their rapid rotation flattens out their spherical shapes by flinging material near the equator outward. Observations of clouds at different latitudes suggest that the Jovian planets rotate at different speeds near their equators than near their poles. The atmospheres of Jupiter and Saturn are made almost entirely of hydrogen and helium, although there is some evidence that they contain hydrogen compounds. Uranus and Neptune are made primarily of hydrogen compounds, with smaller traces of hydrogen, helium, metal and rock. The most common hydrogen compounds are methane, CH4, ammonia, NH3, and water, H2O. The farther away a planet is from the Sun, the cooler its atmosphere will be. This means that the same gases will condense to form clouds at different altitudes on different planets because the condensation of a gas requires a specific amount of pressure and temperature. Ammonia, ammonium hydrosulfide, and water make up the three cloud layers of Jupiter and Saturn. These gases condense at lower altitudes in Saturn's atmosphere than they do in Jupiter's atmosphere. Conclusions. Atmosphere can be divided into five primary levels: troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, thermosphere, and exosphere. Based on the thermal characteristics with altitude, which is affected by the varying composition and reception of types of solar radiation. Each layer is responsible for maintenance of life of the planet. In fact, although most of the planets do have atmosphere, yet with one or more lacking layers, rendering them unsuitable for sustenance of life. The progress of science has been directed towards better understanding of the characteristics and significance of these layers for utilizing them for the development of space and communication technologies, as well as trying to control the anthropogenic activities so as not to disturb the natural stratification of the planet.